To this computer. All right, and we will get started. Hello, everybody. Welcome to our third installment of the Department of Electronic Media and Film's Fall Film Series. This Fall Film Series is themed around invisible architecture. It is in collaboration with the larger CoLab project, Invisible Architectures, that is being directed by myself, Dr. Young, and Professor Ada Pinkston, my co-conspirator over there in the corner. Oh, yeah. And we'll be doing work focusing on different ways to think about truth and reconciliation and reckoning and archival silence at Towson University in Baltimore, Maryland, over the next 3 years. So this fall film series is just an opportunity to watch some films and engage in this conversation of how multiple mediums discuss and think about and grapple with this idea of truth and reconciliation and silence and bringing stories from the margins back into the center. Today's film that we are going to be talking about is the 2016 film, I Am Not Your Negro, directed by Raoul Peck. And all of us who have watched the film know that it is a completion of James Baldwin's last book that he was planning to write that would focus on the lives of Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, Medgar Evers, and my guest respondent today is a co-director for CoLab, Professor Ada Pinkston. And hey, Ada, would you like to introduce yourself a little bit?
Oh, hello, greetings, salutations, good evening on this good Monday, October 18th. I am an artist, educator, cultural organizer, and I am an auntie, and I am a human in these streets.
I'm happy you are a human and not an AI or a robot in these streets, even right. though I would not discriminate against you if you were a robot, in case you need to know that.
You know.
All right. So the question that I have, usually we come up with a question, and that is not the question for this series, but the question that we are grappling with just to start us in our conversation about this film. And those who are joining us and coming on in, you can answer these questions as well, but we always offer it first to our respondent. So in the conversation of watching I Am Not Your Negro, the question that I thought that we could first engage in is, what is the role of the artist when reckoning with injustice? What is the role of the artist and how does that come through in this film specifically? What argument is being made? Take it, Ada. What do you think?
Yeah, so basically, I mean, this film, we were just talking about this just now, right? This is the kind of film where every single time you watch it, you feel more inspired or motivated or more, you know, there's another piece, right, to the text that you pick up, you know. And I think that James Baldwin is one of those artists that very clearly articulates and meditates on what is happening or what happened to him, right? So he's like, he's the witness, but he also took some space away from the witnessing, right? So some space away from the experience. Mm-hmm. Because I feel like as artists, oftentimes we can get lost in the muddle or lost in the muck of all of the layers that are happening in the moment. And it's hard to unpack those layers to clearly communicate and articulate that to somebody else, right? Mm-hmm. You know, so as people are working in their creative production, really the goal is to develop a work or a body of work that inspires an audience or a viewer so much to the point where they can feel, right? Mm-hmm. Like the goal of any work is to feel. And through that feeling, you know, develop a sense of empathy, you know, and also, and have this experience, right? Have this experience clearly communicated and clearly articulated in a way that a lot of, you know, like a drier text, right? Like a text that is just data isn't gonna give, right? Mm-hmm. You know, there's one part of the movie where they're talking about Lorraine Hansberry, right? Mm-hmm. And this Raisin in the Sun. You know, there are different sections of the film that I thought were very impactful, right? Because, you know, James Baldwin is talking about the way that popular media impacted him growing up, right? And how does the articulation of the imaginary of the construct of race, right? Or mm-hmm. how does the articulation of the imaginary of the nation state, that the US, right? Mm-hmm. How does that contradict what the reality is for everyone, right?
Right.
And how does that cognitive dissonance impact a civilization, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so this Raisin in the Sun piece, is one of Lorraine Hansberry's. I like that work, but I really, really, really enjoy Le Blanc, right? Mm. And that was one of her last theatrical pieces. Mm-hmm. And it really, in a very, you know, she really articulates the violence of colonialism in a very poetic way, right? And it's not, you know, and that's another thing, right? As the artist, there's so many nuanced ways to uplift a story without saying, okay, this genocide happened, right? It's like, it's the story of a colonial relationship, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's interwoven through the narrative of these two family members, right? One of them decides to go the path of the colonial route and converts to Christianity, and the other one is maintaining their position as a freedom fighter. And both of them, you know, that's the conflict, right? It's the you know, so tying in the personal, right? The personal conflict to the larger political experience.
Anyway, I think essentially what an artist does, like when reckoning with justice or injustices?
I think, you know, depending on the type of artist a person wants to be, right? Because there are some artists that don't. There are some artists that are only interested in the articulation of an aesthetic experience that is beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's fine too. One could argue that that is also political because of thinking about the subjectivity of what is beautiful, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's interesting. You've brought on so many different threads, and it's making my brain sort of ping in multiple places. I'm thinking about this sort of conversation of the many different ways that artists tell story. Right, the many different ways that it comes through. I think that, and there is something that can be revolutionary about telling the story in such a way that you don't have to say, yeah, this is a story about genocide, but people feel it. Like there's something to be said for approaching it that way. And then I know that there's also a school of thought that says approaching with a subtlety does an injustice to something that's that needs to be plainly spoken, right? It's just like sometimes the poetics of art, some people feel like that gets in the way of the sort of truth-telling part of the art, if that makes any sense. And I don't necessarily ascribe to that. I think be as poetic as you need to be, but I think sometimes we have some interesting weighing in or shifts that occur around that. Rachel or Francine, how would y'all like to weigh in on this question? Because me and Ada can talk forever, but y'all in a group with us, so talk. Come.
I think about, I'm thinking back to when I first learned about James Baldwin and what his work was about, and it was 1987, and that's the year that he passed away. I was an undergrad, just started. And so I've been, you know, as the years have passed, learning more and more and seeing how deeply radical he was. And when I think about James Baldwin, I think about how he was this amazing artist, but he's also had this way of definitely letting us in on how the injustice and white supremacy in America deeply impacted him. So when I'm thinking about the role of this artist, my mind goes to how painful in some ways, he calls himself an optimist, but the pain of having these realizations about, you know, his country and how there's no place for him and Black people in this country. I think about how he created this art, but the space, you know, him leaving and going overseas to give himself some space to like just to be and also to create. But how does he, you know, when you're holding this really awful contradiction of this country and also speaking about it and writing about it and debating about it, and your colleagues, your friends are all doing that same work, like how that tension manifests, you know, in him. That's what I think about. And so I think he's given us some amazing, amazing work. And then I also think about it at what cost. That's what I tend to think about. And so that's what I have to offer to that question.
Gotcha. Yeah. People make I think there's an interesting part, even I think at the beginning of this documentary, where he articulates, he sees the integration of the school and he's just like, all right, I need to get back home, right? He gets this call to come home where he has been in France and doing, just being as an artist. But I don't know if you can just be as an artist at any time, right? I feel like that's kind of a weird little dual. I don't know. You're nodding your head, Ada. Wax for me, girl.
I think he was, it was, when he was there, it was a space for him to reflect and see. He was able to take the mirror and point it across the ocean, but also take the mirror and point it at himself, right? Because he's talking about the Algerian experience. There's this essay called Stranger in the Village that he wrote about he was dating this Nordic person, and they were in this like very Nordic village, where he was the only Black person, right? And but he talks about that experience and like the difference between his experience as a Black person from the US in Europe, and how people's response to him is less about disassociating him from his humanity, but more just ignorance, period. And I think I hear, you know, Francine, I hear you when you're talking about like how does that manifest in a person's, you know, all of the weight of that, or all of the layers, or the really the gravity, right? How does the gravity of constantly reckoning with the reality that one is experiencing in the moment, and then also like working towards knowing that your work as a witness is so important that you have to write it down, right? Because I mean, you know, at the end of the day, like anyone could just be like, you know what, I'm not gonna do this, I'm just gonna be blind, right?
Yes. Right. There right. is a choice to just be like, it's too big for me. Yeah. Right. It's too big for me. Step away. But certain artists step into it as opposed to stepping away. I feel like James Baldwin is one of those artists.
Yeah. And I think that's also why his work is so timeless. We were talking about this, right?
Yeah.
Like, you can pick up any of his texts and it's still relevant today.
Yeah.
Still relevant today.
Right. So what does that say about his insights at the moment versus our lack of movement? Like, are those two things contradictory, right? Was it because he was prescient, or was it because he just totally understood what the problem would be? Like, what the problems were? I see you unmuted yourself, Fran.
Yeah, he got it. He's like, we're never going to move until white America faces itself. Like, we're not going to move any faster than the speed of white America to acknowledge this. And I think that's the acknowledge and act and give up, you know, give up this, you know, this game, you know, in a sense, you know, when he talks about the end, you know, that he, you know, the title of the movie, I'm not sure, Negro, you know, but what he actually said was the N word. And it's, I feel like he's just so amazing because I deal with the same issue at my current job where there's, you know, for a little over a year, pre my joining the organization, they began DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion training and trying to, you know, in the wake of George Floyd's murder, trying to, as an all-white ad agency, trying to learn more and to do more around this clear injustice in America. And I'll just say in brief that, you know, I joined about 7 months ago and saw, you know, the lineup of conversations around, you know, more equitable hiring and talking about, you know, our language and how language evolves. In talking in the DEI space. And I brought up, well, has there been a conversation about white supremacy in this lineup of conversations? And was told no. And I said, well, I think that's important because we're not having any of these other conversations without the fact that white supremacy exists. So if we don't point and have these conversations, to at least begin the conversation about white supremacy, be able to speak it, the words, number one, those two words together, at the same time as a group, then what are we doing? We're dancing around it. So that's what draws me back to what, you know, I feel James Baldwin was saying is like, until white America reckons with itself, what are we doing? We're gonna keep going in circles because it's always pointing and trying to find the answer to the problem outside of itself.
Gotcha. Rachel, we've been talking a lot. Do you have any insights or thoughts? Had you ever seen the documentary before?
No, I have not. And I actually, I'm just kind of soaking in your guys' knowledge because I'm not very knowledgeable about it much at all. I'm here for a class, actually.
Gotcha.
To learn.
Gotcha. Have you ever read any James Baldwin before?
No, I have not.
Read some James Baldwin.
Huh?
I said, read some James Baldwin.
It's unfortunate. It wasn't until college that I actually started reading anything from, you know, any, especially more modern Black authors or studying any Black artists. And, you know, it actually, if I'm being completely honest, it wasn't even until last fall that I truly understood what structural racism was in America.
Mm-hmm.
So I've read a lot from Coates and I'm trying to remember the book that I read last year. I read, why can I not remember the name of this author? I apologize. A lot of I've gone over and learned about has been predominantly about inequalities in education and how that translates for a lot of students into, you know, cultural behavior. I don't want to say cultural behaviors, but like how they've, I talked with a lot of students from Baltimore City Schools who discussed how they felt like people have projected that, you know, like a lack of education is a part of who they are, which is not the case, and how important education and art is for them. So that's a lot of where like my understanding comes from, but no, I'm not very familiar with James Baldwin.
Well, how would you answer that the big prompt just from your own sort of perspective of someone who's thinking about these things now? Like, what role do you think artists have in reckoning with injustice?
Well, for me, I feel like art is capable of expressing feelings and emotions, and I feel like art is able to express what maybe we can't always express with words. So with James Baldwin, I know you said that he writes, but was his medium for art, was it predominantly written, or was it other forms of medium?
He's a writer.
He's a writer. Okay, thank you. So to me, I feel like writing, it gives you a voice, and it gives you a space that maybe that where society wouldn't give you a space to speak before. And mm-hmm. So I feel like when you look at publications and you look at writing, whether that be prose or through poetry, it's an art form, maybe not in a visual sense, but it gives a voice to people who are told you're not allowed to have a voice out loud.
Right. Gotcha. I gotcha. Thank you for adding that. And thank you also for being willing to come in and like soak in some new information. And now I'm going to have to send you. Are you a Towson student?
Yes, I am.
All right, man. Now I'm going to have to send you like a whole book list. You're going to get too many readings from me. That's just FYI. Yeah, like.
You know what, definitely. Rachel, to your point, this is intentional, right? Like, think about, you know, why are there so many states where so many books are banned from the public school curriculum, right?
Ooh, yeah.
You know, and there's some states where you can't even mention the institution of slavery in pre-K through 12th grade curriculum, specifically Texas. I'll just say that.
Yeah, in Texas.
You can't talk about slavery. There's so many books that are banned from public schools. And then it's, you know, so this denial, right? The denial is a part of it, but it's also like intentionally mm-hmm. denying everyone, right? Knowledge that could actually be helpful to reach us closer to all of our humanity, right?
Right.
It's a, you know, the construct of whiteness is one of the things that separates. It's not even about this is what he says at the end of the film. It's not about us. Right? The mm-hmm. mythology of Negro was created, right?
Right.
Just the construction of whiteness erases every, you know, he talks about this in some of his books.
Mm-hmm.
The construction of whiteness erases every single culture that exists in Europe, really. Right.
Right.
Right. Right. It like flattens entire cultures into like one collapsible thing. That it needs to have an abject to compare itself against. One thing is the norm and one thing is not. So yeah, it's so funny when we think about educational settings, I think about how blessed I was to some extent to have grown up in Baltimore, to grow up in a majority Black city and go to majority Black schools from elementary, middle, and high school. And also in my middle school, because of the specific kind of time frame that we were in, in that interesting like late 80s, early 90s space, my middle school, every floor of our middle school was named after a famous Black person.
Mm.
And we all had to learn about that particular person on every different level as we went through middle school,
mm.
right? Mm. Like that we didn't do the Pledge of Allegiance. We sang the Black National Anthem at the beginning of the school day, every single day, right? That it wasn't like Black History Month. Like Black History Month was a big old deal, but it was like Black History Month every single day. Right. And I think about how I just don't know how many educational, especially public school educational systems, would have that structure now unless they were charter schools. Unless you're a charter school, that's the only time. But like we had to read people. But you know what's really interesting? We could not read any folks like Baldwin who were Black and queer.
Mm.
And that was extremely telling as well.
Mm. No,
right? No Audre Lorde, we couldn't get up in that. Nope, 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 nope.
Mm-hmm.
So, hi, Lori.
Hi, sorry.
It's all right. The prompt that we're really grappling with, but we're going all over the place with it, because that's how this film series works, is what is the role of the artist when reckoning with injustice? And I was wondering, having watched the documentary, like, what were your thoughts?
Oh, sorry, I'm having a hard time tonight.
Oh, babe. Oh. Oh.
Sorry. Oh. I had thoughts, though. I wanted to be part of it. I just had such a hard time getting in.
Oh.
Frustrated.
Oh. Oh, babe. I'm so sorry. I wish
it just made me, it made me register 3 times and change my password 3 times. And I was just so frustrated because I wanted to be on time. And I'm just like, sorry. So I had thoughts about that. So like,
Hold on one second. Giant cyber hug to you, my friend and colleague.
No, it's okay. It's okay. I'm very easily freaked out when stuff doesn't work and I'm late. So I was thinking, by artist, do you mean Baldwin or do you mean, and I'm sorry, I forgot his name already, the guy that directed this film and chose to leave out his queerness. As part of his identity, there was just that one little FBI thing. And I'm sorry if you guys already talked about this. I missed it.
No, we did not. We literally have been just hanging out in that first question this whole entire time, girl. It's cool.
Yeah, very, yeah.
So, I had not seen this film before. And there were several parts that really struck me. And the thing at the end when he said, you didn't have to look at me, I had to look at you. Mm. And you gave me a powerful weapon because I know you better than you know me, was a really amazing line that he said. And juxtaposed with the lynching shot, the shot of the lynching was so strong. And I've got disjointed thoughts. The role of the artist, let's see. And I'm wondering if you have thoughts, I'm just kind of discombobulated. I wonder if you had thoughts about the erasure of his queerness. Was that one road too many because there was so much going on with him? Did the filmmaker of this film think that it would muddy the waters, or was it a resistance among the Black audience, particularly other men? And I mean, like there's, you know, so I wasn't really sure what to make of that.
Mm-hmm.
So those are some of the things I was thinking. Sorry, it's not very coherent.
Oh, that's all right. Yeah.
No, I think it's totally totally coherent. We got where you're coming from. Ada, did you want to pick up that thread, or you want me to pick it up and then snowball? How you feel?
You know what's interesting? Yeah, I mean, I was having this conversation with a friend of mine this past weekend about sexuality in general. So, you know, so we think, so I have a feeling that this director might have been like less focused on his work and not his personal life,
mm-hmm.
right? Because there's so much in just his work, right?
Right.
There's so many beautiful silhouettes to follow, right? In the painting of his work, and I feel like the story of his life is different.
Mm-hmm.
But it also brings up the question, because, you know, have you guys seen MLK, FBI, FBI MLK? It's this documentary about how Martin Luther King was also being surveilled by the FBI.
Mm-hmm.
And in it, the director talks about how someone from the FBI wrote this letter to his wife, or no, wrote this letter to him, but his wife
tell him to kill himself. That one?
Exactly. Telling him to kill himself because they're like, we know that you're gay, or we know that you have infidelities outside of your marriage, et cetera, et cetera. But what's interesting though, is that he kept going, right? Mm-hmm. He was like, okay, like people were less interested in his personal life and more interested in his work and in the important work that he did, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is in the 60s, right? In the 50s and 60s, right? So I think, at the end of this film, this FBI MLK film, they talk about how some parts of his files are gonna be revealed, right? Because they were recording him okay, no worries, Rachel. I see you're gonna leave. All right, have a good evening. Take care of yourself.
Yeah, sweetheart, peace.
But yeah, I bring that up. So basically, once MLK's files are released, so there's been conversations about Martin Luther King and Malcolm X actually not mm-hmm. being great.
Mm-hmm.
And that was also in some of Malcolm X's, some people that were close to him wrote some stuff about that as well. But, you know, a lot of people are like, well, why even focus on that? Again, like people today, like why posthumously like bring up all of this stuff about a person's personal life? Because right. It's their personal life. It has nothing to do with the, you know, like the impact of this work.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there is, I don't know, maybe there's space for that in 200 years or something. But right now, the fact of the matter is, I mean, I feel like, or maybe there's space for that now too, but those are just two separate films.
I kind of piggyback on you on that part, Ada, in terms of like Baldwin and his queerness in this film, right? Like James Baldwin was never not out.
He was always out, yeah.
Right? He was always gay. So his gayness is not a surprise to Black people. So the audience wouldn't be sweating that. Do you know what I'm saying? The audience wouldn't sweat it, because anyone who reads Baldwin and knows Baldwin knew that he was out and he was a homosexual and he was clear about it. So that's one. He had a level of ability to be out that I think is very different than Martin Luther King or Malcolm X or any other person, right? Because he was a writer. Right? And as a writer, that sometimes gives you like a little bit more of a buffer. And then I also think that this film it's not a biop, right? It's about how would we complete James Baldwin's book, right? The book that he wanted to write, but he never finished. And I think that's just a different story. I think the director was sort of grappling with something different. But how can you really divorce a person's, like, and this is the quintessential question that we always run into, right? It's like that Roland Barthes, sort of that kind of death of the author thing, right? Like, how important do I need to see an artist's statement to be able to watch this work or read this work or see this work in a museum, right? How important is that artist statement? And I think that's always going to come in when we're thinking about people's personal lives and their work.
Yeah, I mean, because the personal is political, right? Like when we think about, okay, like Dostoevsky or something, right? Like people if we think about Matisse, right? Like there are people or historians that are very interested in the intricacies and inner workings of the life of these artists.
Mm-hmm.
But then there are some historians that are literally only interested in the inner workings of the layers of their paintings or the layers of their writing. And those are, you know, those are two different things. And also I think it's interesting though, too, like why, what is it about us? But I guess with James though, like I feel like with his work lends itself, like I think that his intimacy with white people, right? Mm-hmm. It created a space for him to write what he wrote, really, right?
Right, right.
And that's a personal, you know, that's part of his personal life, but yeah.
Mm-hmm. It allowed him some space and some access.
Mm-hmm.
And it also allowed him to see, to observe in very close proximity to whiteness in mm-hmm. a way that, but you know, I don't know how many of y'all have like read interesting things that like when you read in my PhD program, I spent a whole summer like really just immersing myself in like slave narratives.
Mm.
Right. And then reading all of the slave stories that were told when they in the 1930s, when they went back and were talking to the last of the folks who had been a part of American slavery, like Zora Neale Hurston had done all that kind of work. So you interview people who were formerly enslaved.
Mm.
And one of the threads in so many of these narratives were about those, about the folks being enslaved being able to observe how whiteness works,
mm-hmm.
right? The close intimacy of being the mammy. You're in that person's home, raising their kids. You know what's in their refrigerator. You know what's in their drawers as well, right? That there's a way that the abject figure, which would be the Black figure in these stories, has an intimacy with whiteness that white folks don't even realize they are being observed and the score is being known, is getting known by the Black folks that are in those intimate spaces. And I think that James Baldwin was in that position because of his proximity to white spaces and the fact that he was accepted into these white spaces
mm-hmm.
to be able to do that kind of observational work and then reflect it back and truly kind of understand that like, no, that's your problem.
Yeah,
we're just having to deal with that. I don't know. Does that make
it does? Yeah. But then it's also, I mean, I often wonder, like, did James Baldwin and Bayard Rustin hang out all the time?
I hope so.
You know what I'm saying? Like, these are.
I hope they came to Baltimore and went to a ball and was doing some dips and stuff. I really hope so.
You know, or did they not? Right. Was it? So for people that don't know who Bayard Rustin was an organizer. I don't know what that documentary was called, but that one.
Yeah, I know the one you're talking about. His documentary that came out in like 2012.
Yeah, I don't remember what it's called, but that one very clearly talks about his personal life because he was intentionally erased from the civil rights movement.
Was it Brother Outsider?
That's it.
Boom.
Brother Outsider, yes.
Look at us. That's why we co-directed together.
Okay. Yes, Brother Outsider mm-hmm. is a beautiful film.
Mm-hmm.
He was organizing since from the 40s. Like he was part of the Pullman, like he organized the Pullman Porters.
Right. It's like queer Black activists have been in these streets for a really long time. It's like when you think about folks like Bayard Rustin and you think about James Baldwin. And I think the extra additional layer, and I might be just projecting, but I think the extra additional layer of also being queer provides a level of ability to read more, right? Like proximity to whiteness means you're able to sit there and observe whiteness. Proximity to heterosexuality means you get to sit and look at heterosexuality too, right? And be a bit of an observer of the way that people contort and reorganize and organize themselves around that particular part of identity too. It's something about being the brother outsider status often that allows a level of observance, even mm-hmm. if that means you can't necessarily be included all the time. Francine, Lori, what are y'all thoughts, homies?
Didn't he say a thing about when he was in Paris and he saw the young woman being tormented, just trying to go to school? And he said it was time for me to basically get off the bench. And I wondered if that outsider status that he had as part of himself, but also as self-imposed because of his identity as a writer, was the thing that made him want to do what you're saying is proximity and distance at the same time. Mm-hmm. And if he is a writer who wants to have a certain objectivity, I don't know that he did. It didn't sound to me like he wanted to have objectivity, but mm-hmm. maybe the stance of writerliness kept him at a kind of remove mm-hmm. from the goings on. And then at that moment where he said, no, I have to go back and join the fight now. And so I sometimes wondered if being a writer is to keep yourself separate a little bit, because maybe you're trying to keep that voice or that viewing position somewhat isolated, somewhat pure. And mm-hmm. He said, it's time to go back and get my hands dirty. Mm-hmm. And so that was an interesting way for him to put that. And it just struck me as kind of like what you were saying about being on the inside and the outside at the same time. I mean, ultimately the outsider status is part of his brilliance. He was probably always the smartest guy in the room. Also his queerness, his blackness, going to the South, to Alabama as a well-educated, well-traveled African-American man made him even more of an alien in that environment. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? Mm-hmm. It's that sort of that faint, damning with faint praise. Oh, so articulate, you know, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I was just thinking about him as a writer. I don't know if that.
Is it particular to the medium of writing? Yeah. Now that makes me think I should go back in my brain and think about the Toni Morrison documentary, right? Like, did that level, being a writer, sort of shift her ability to be able to be close but far away as well? What is it about the medium? And maybe it's not just the writer, maybe that's just art, you know? I don't know.
I mean, if you see, because one could even say like the craft of acting, right? Like, you know, the section of the film where they had Harry Belafonte, Sidney mm-hmm. Poitier, these were artists, or Ozzie Davis and Ruby Dee, right? Mm-hmm. These were artists that were very also much involved in some form of liberation struggle in addition to being a part of Hollywood, right? Mm-hmm. Marlon Brando at the time, right? Mm-hmm. I think I think also this idea, one thing that I appreciate, another thing I appreciate about this film was the scenes that were in color, you know, some of the scenes that were in color, and also there are different parts when it was edited where it's like, okay, he just said some really mind-blowing stuff and mic drop, right? Mm-hmm. Or specifically, there's the part where where he's talking about the difference between the North and the South, mm-hmm. not really being that far, right?
And right.
But, you know, when he said that though, because that the construction is also part of it, right? Like the construction right. of who is the good and who is the bad, or like mm-hmm. the civil rights movement was so long ago. Cause as I was watching that, I was like, I was wondering the kids that are throwing, you know, that have the swastika signs, like where are they today?
Mm-hmm. They're older or dead or teaching their grandbabies how to make swastikas. Right? Like perpetuating a thing. Yeah, I found that I did really enjoy always the sections where the conversation gets uncomfortable in this documentary, mm-hmm. where you can tell that he is uncomfortable and people are uncomfortable being in this space and he's staying forthright. I think I was rewatching little bits of it before tonight, before we came on. And I think I'd stop just at this conversation where it's James Baldwin, Martin Luther King, and Malcolm X. And in this conversation, like Malcolm X is dragging Martin Luther King like nobody's business. Like he is dragging him over the rails. He's Uncle Tom and him. He's doing all this work, right? And I thought about how interesting when you have that going on, who are as James Baldwin, as you watch these two figures, right, going at it. And then he eventually, it's just like, and he, as the witness of this conflict, he's also able to witness later on exactly how these two men influenced each other and took the mantle, how Martin Luther King took the mantle from Malcolm X and kept on going. And that's when Martin Luther King was assassinated, right? Mm-hmm. When he started going after class and going after money and going after capitalism and all that jazz. So I just think that that is interesting to have like Baldwin kind of like the observer of that tension, and then also to be able to see how that tension flowed before he passed and to rearticulate that. Mm. Like that maybe some of the job, at least of the artist, is to almost to not just the witness, but to be to the synthesizer, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The synthesizer, right? The person that is fabulating, right? The dreamer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The body. Welder. Yeah, the welder. All of that. Yeah. What are some other scenes that stand out for y'all? Or other little observations that you have?
Well, I was really enjoying how uncomfortable Dick Cavett was snotty, whatever Harvard philosopher guy came in and it's like, oh, well, you know, you have more in common with, you know, a white writer than with a black, some other someone who doesn't like literature, as if writing is his only, like, that he never leaves the house and encounters the outside world and other people. And he just is this kind of isolated, esoteric man in a little tower and never has to get down with the masses and, you know, pay bills and buy groceries and go on public transportation and walk down the street and deal with police and deal with other authority figures and gatekeepers, as if it's just this isolated life. That apparently the philosophy guy imagined, and Baldwin just took him to town on that one and said, well, you know, I don't know if the realtor hates me, but I do know the result of what he does. And then I don't know if the education people hate me, but I do know what they're teaching me and my kids and what they're putting in the textbooks. And the guy's just like, oh yeah, okay, good point. It's just like wilting as he talked. And he did it so brutally, but also with such clarity of his examples.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not that, I mean, I'm sure he's had to come up with those examples on the spot before. He's thought about them, maybe written about them, but he just was able to marshal them so quickly. And it's not even like a normal person where you think of what you should have said like 2 days later.
Right. James Baldwin wasn't in the shower thinking, I could have said it.
Mm-mm. Yeah. He just came up with it. And this was that guy just thinking, you know, we have more in common above the little people because we're writers and we're deep thinkers, and not even imagining that there was a personal life attached to that person, you know. Right. It was just and Dick Cavett's just like, oh my god,
he's like, I don't even know what to do with this.
It's like, oh please, is it time for a commercial? He just didn't know what to do. And it was, but I mean, you know, I was glad that he mm-hmm. put them in that space together so that that moment could happen. So, you know. Right.
I think that's so interesting though. I think about that moment and it reminds me, there's just the beauty and queerness of James Baldwin that I love watching him speak. Like, he is giving you shade. Do you know what I'm saying? He is doing the most in the most articulate and brilliant and fast and lightning fast way, right? Okay. He will not be in the shower thinking, I could have said this. He thought it and it came out, and it came out brilliantly through his vessel, right? Mm-hmm. And I think it's really also interesting to think about that philosopher having this extremely white understanding of intellectualism and art and art making. Like, nobody else gets to go up to the mountain by themselves. And who was that author? I'm thinking about some famous white author. So he lived in the woods for like, what, 2 years or something like that to Thoreau? Write all the stuff. Was it Thoreau, right? He is able to do all that. Like, yeah, I lived in the mountains 2 years. You was on your granddaddy's estate. Mm. That's why you was able. And somebody came and brought you meals. Mm. Like, nobody was coming on our states and any other marginalized artist's estate and just like, here's your meals, go in and keep writing. That is like the treasure experience. So I think maybe James Baldwin's hackles got raised at that moment as well, around that kind of articulation of intellectual labor and art.
Yeah.
And he did it with like you were saying, Colm, of the shade aspect. Like, he didn't get mad. I mean, you could feel that there was rage involved, but he presented it in a way that was more effective, especially mm-hmm. for that guy to who he was talking to, mm-hmm. to cut him back with words,
mm-hmm.
you know, rather than visible anger. I mean, whatever anger he felt, and I'm sure he felt a lot, he channeled it into this argument that could not be refuted. And he put words as his weapon. And I mean, that's a super obvious thing to say about a writer who's really fast on his feet like that. But that was the way to refute a man like that who said it, as you say, you know, artistic and creative labor. From this place of privilege. There's no better way to take that guy downtown than to just use words
mm-hmm.
and logic.
Right. So. Yeah. Ada, were you adding something on, babe?
I don't even remember what I was going to say, so I guess it's not important. Yeah. What were we talking about?
You're talking about James Baldwin taking folks down on that Dick Cavick show, and
right,
the privilege of having your retreat.
Yeah, but that guy, let me tell you, he sounded like he was a social scientist. I feel like there's a moment in at that particular time, late 70s, early 80s, where social scientists are like, okay, well, how are we going to deal with the Negro problem, right? They're still trying to figure out how to deal with it. Yeah. So he seemed like a psychologist. So there's like different forms. There's the sociologists that are like, oh, it's the individual. Mm-hmm. Or there's a psychologist that's like, oh, it's the individual. And then there's a sociologist, and psychologists are like, oh, it's, no, we got to think about everything else. He mm-hmm. struck me as one of those individual type of schools, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which I think, you know, a lot of people to this day still follow behind, right?
Right. As if we're not social animals, and that right. our ways of interacting aren't always bounded by our social relationship to ourselves right. and the communities and the spaces that we're in. There's no way you can pull a person out to just the individual exactly. and say anything about a whole mass of people.
Right. But I mean, people still try to do that. It's very fascinating, right? I mean, because the individual experience is important, and also, you know, everything else, right? Like the centuries and centuries of colonialism right. and impact. Yeah. All and right. the impact of trauma on people's DNA and so on. But
Cool. So I'm going to open it for just like any last sort of thoughts, because it's like 8:34 and generally this runs for about an hour or so. But any other thoughts or scenes or aspects that folks want to engage with while we are in here in this cozy environment with one another?
I'm reminded, I can't remember if it was in this documentary or not, but the quote, I'm paraphrasing really badly, where James Baldwin is saying, you know, you've taken my mother's time and my father's time and my brother's time. How much time do you want, you know, us to wait for liberation in essence? And I was just thinking about what Lori was saying about this channeled anger. I hear when I read Baldwin, when I see him speak, just this irritation. It's like he's an artist who's reflecting back very clearly what white supremacy is and does. And there's this impatience of, you all are fucking with my life and the lives of people who I love. And so that's what really resonates with me a lot when I think about James Baldwin. He just was very raw in that way. This very raw artist, and just did not care if he, you know, rubbed someone the wrong way, the way he's going to state what he had to state. It was like he was past that point of caring about how he was viewed by white America, particularly, you know, around these things he had to say. And that just level of just irritation and disgust with the world he was born into just always has set, you know, like I told you, since 87, just really sits with me in this way. He's just one of my heroes. Call me, you know, I have t-shirts, I have pins.
You got everything. You know,
with James Baldwin's quotes and his likeness, because he just was so singularly on fire about freedom, and that's what I wanted to add.
Word, we appreciate your fan club, yo.
Yeah,
I love this one thing that he said was about whiteness and or America as being the word he said was immaturity. I just thought, oh my god, because the pandemic has brought out something that I guess I knew, but I didn't say, you know, say it in a sentence, is that America is like the whiny, petulant teenager of the world, you know, like, you're not the boss of me. And it just brought this out. And then he added on, you know, so somebody like John Wayne never had to grow up. You know, and I've never thought of it that way, but it makes so much sense. I mean, you know, I felt sad about his what he said about Doris Day a little bit, but I got what he was saying. But the thing about like heroes, and they never have to grow up, and there is this kind of you know, man-child thing that's always held up in a heroic way, rather than, you know, people who do the work of being open to change and like really looking at the way things are. And his labeling of it as immaturity was so spot on, because it does evoke this kind of like, I don't have to grow up. I can resist looking at the way things really are. I can ignore what's going on behind the curtain. I don't need to know how the sausages are made, you know, that kind of thing.
Right. Right. And that's a particular kind of privilege that many people do not have, but this country has a lot of it, all of it, at the expense of a whole bunch of other people. I think one of the things that always gets me, and I think it's because it runs so in line with like my African-American cinema class, parts of my class, but that line where he talks about being a young child growing up and watching movies and watching John Wayne and cheering for you know, folks like that. And then suddenly around about 5 to 7, you realize you are the Indians. You're cheering the person who's killing you. And I feel like that is one of the clearest articulations of that coming awareness of racism and white supremacy that Black children experience all the time. I remember this distinct moment. I feel like I came out the womb kind of like this. That's what my mama used to say. But I figured it out kind of early on. But it's that moment of realizing like, the way this story is being told is whack because these people are not good guys. The good guys are not the good guys, right? And I'm literally the person they're shooting off the horse. And like that articulation and that scene and the picture of the little boy with the cowboy hat and all of that just really always just kicks me right in the gut and makes me think about how the impact of media on the kids and people's sort of understanding of who they are, what they're allowed to be, and how the world sees them. And I think a lot of when I think about James Baldwin as well, I think about him laboring under that burden of representation as well. Because when you are one of the elite few that have to articulate all the things, there's an awful lot of pressure there too.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But he kept going, right? And I think, you know,
mm-hmm.
And so there's something, it's like, I don't know if it's like a higher life force or high, you know, is it God? Is it, what is it that compelled him to keep going, right? In spite of and in the face of all of that, right?
Right.
You know that, yeah.
I think it goes back to him saying his like sort of whimsical moment of like, I am the oldest of, I'm older than Malcolm, I'm older than Martin, I was older than Medgar Evans. I was supposed to go first, right? And he had to bear witness to their passings, you know? And I think there's a responsibility that kind of comes with being the witness that you do just keep going. That's the job. All right, so. Thank y'all for coming in and having, this was, I know we were small but mighty. It was really nice to talk to all of y'all about like one of my favorite documentaries in the whole universe. Lori, I'm sorry you had tech difficulties, my dear. Kisses and hugs to you. That can be frustrating. Oh man, that's frustrating.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you.
What was that? What'd you say?
Thank you.
Yeah. And Ada, thank you for being the respondent. Thanks for being my co-conspirator and all such things. Really appreciate it. And thank you, Francine. And thank you, Tracy, for captioning. And next week is our last day of the fall film series. We'll be unpacking and talking about the film Three Billboards Outside of Ebbing, Missouri. I think I have on the hook as one of my respondents will be one of the people from the Rape Crisis Counseling Center turnaround to sort of talk about personal justice and what does that look like. So I hope y'all can pop on in at 7:30 for this conversation. I'm going to stop the recording and say thank y'all, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah. Peace. Thank you.